Bill, thank you so much for taking time to be with me today. And I just have a few questions I want to ask you about your entry into activism and advice you have for young people. So let's start with what events or beliefs in your youth led you to become an activist?
I grew up in enormous privilege in the suburbs of Chicago. I came of age in the early 1960s, and I was raised in the church. My folks had a very tenuous relationship with organized religion, but I kind of grew up in the secular American creed that everyone is equal, that everyone is deserving of respect, that everyone should have a life of dignity and peace and freedom. Those were the things that were just in the world that I lived in. I breathed them in. And then I came of age in the early 1960s, and I saw the ways in which those beautiful sounding values were actually not realized and not lived. And in fact, there were all kinds of policies and politics and initiatives that undermined those very values. And that hypocrisy or that contradiction kind of woke me up. I feel like I grew up in tremendous privilege with large kind of walls against seeing the world as it was. And by about the age of 18 or 19, the walls around that world were collapsing. And I looked out and I saw a world on fire. And opening my eyes, waking up to that, was really the first impulse toward activism. And I feel very fortunate that I grew up at a time when the great civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s was defining the moral territory in America. And I found it very easy, in some sense, to be drawn to that and to decide that I wanted to cast my fate with the people who were trying to make that secular ideal of freedom, equality, and peace real. And that's what drove me into activism. The first kinds of things I got involved in, I was at the University of Michigan, and there was a pizza parlor that didn't allow Black students to eat there. Kind of astonishing to think about in 1963, 64. But it was true. And so a group of friends of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee picketed that restaurant. I joined the picket line. First time in my life I had ever done anything like that. And I could almost hear my lovely, quiet, middle-class mother sitting on my shoulder saying, "Bill, don't make a spectacle." And I realized something important in that picket line. I realized that when you stand up, you actually find who your friends are and you find what community you're a part of. And you also find who some of the crazies are. There was actually a group of friends of mine coming into the pizza parlor, and they saw me on the picket line and they pushed me and said, "Don't be a jerk." And I thought, me, I'm not being a jerk. I'm doing the right thing. And it was that kind of sense of standing up and, you know, makes a difference. I realized something, and that was that the opposite of courage isn't cowardice. The opposite of courage is conformity. And I realized that I had to stand up for certain things I believed in, partly because there's a great joy in standing with others against injustice. There's a great feeling of purpose, you know, that comes from that. But I also felt that standing up helps you define who you are. In other words, the calculus of my activism wasn't always success. The calculus was often, who do I want to be as a human being? Do I want to be on the freedom side or not? Do I want to be on the side of peace or do I not? And that kind of sustained me, that sense. And I got really right from the beginning a sense of exhilaration at trying together to overcome some injustice. Shortly after the picket line, which was my first public display, I was arrested inside the draft board in Ann Arbor, Michigan. 39 of us sat in and got arrested that day, opposing the war in Vietnam. Once again, there was a slight sense of fear, definitely. We sang songs and linked arms to allay our fears. But more than that, there was a sense of exhilaration, a sense actually of freedom. Even though we were sitting down and the police were rounding us up, paradoxically, that's when I felt most free. I had never felt that free because it turns out that freedom is more than choosing which kind of ice cream to have. Real freedom has to do with naming an obstacle to your humanity or to the humanity of your brothers and sisters, and then moving against that obstacle. The sense of exhilaration is hard to overestimate because it was really that sense of there we were face to face, arm in arm, shoulder to shoulder, trying to do something that was right and that we felt right about. So that was huge. I also feel like right then it came to me that being active in the civil rights movement, which was, of course, the great upheaval in the centuries-old struggle for Black freedom, and we're experiencing another upheaval in that long line of struggle. And I think that's exciting as it can possibly be, more exciting right now. But the sense that I got right then in my early 20s was, again, that the opposite of moral is not immoral. The opposite of moral is indifferent. And I didn't want to be indifferent. I didn't want to just let the world roll quietly by with my either my eyes shut or my eyes open and a kind of cynical shrug. I wanted to do something. I found that doing something with others actually elevates your sense of possibility. It elevates your sense of purpose and meaning in the world. That was my struggle, and that was my journey.
What continues to motivate you, drive you to be an activist? What gives you hope? What gives you courage?
You point to the fact, Connie, that I came of age and became an activist in the middle 1960s. But one of the things I've felt forever and feel more intensely today than ever is that there is no such thing as the 60s. There was a sense of real hope, and partly it's the hope of youth. There was a sense of possibility. I think what was unique for me about that time is we actually thought we would win. We thought we would end a war. We thought we would end apartheid in America. It turned out to be much more difficult, much more of a long haul than we imagined. But nobody looked at their watch on December 31st, 1969 and said, oh my God, it's almost over. What am I going to do? Nobody lives by decades. That's all marketing. That's all retrospect. I grew from the early 1960s as the public political activist trying to create and participate in the public square. I'm still at it. And I'm now 76 years old. And I never felt that there was a break between this and that. Certainly there is an ebb and flow to history, but even the way we talk about the great Black freedom movement of the 60s is almost like defangs it and makes it linear and makes it obvious. Actually, when you live through it, it was as complicated as any time on earth. I was a member of Students for a Democratic Society and eventually a leader of that organization. And our membership cards said right on the back of them, we are people of this generation, bred in at least modest comfort, looking uneasily at the world we inherit. That is still how I feel. I'm still a member of this generation. I'm not dead yet. I don't see a big split between somebody who's 70. You know, I'm living now, and I'm not nostalgic for a ship that already left the shore. I'm eager for the next step. And whatever the so-called 60s was, it was prelude to what we have to do today. There is an interesting continuation, which is the fight for Black freedom, which, as I said, is centuries old, is not over. And we are in the latest upsurge, the latest iteration of that long, long, long struggle. And it's an invitation for everyone to join now. In other words, everyone knows that they would have been on the Edmund Pettus Bridge with Martin Luther King. Everybody knows they would have been with Harriet Tubman freeing the slaves. But that's not good enough. It's what do we know now? What are we doing now? Because now is what calls us, and now is what is urgent. So I feel like very much a person of this generation, looking uneasily at the world we inherit, looking with disappointment at our failures to accomplish some of the obvious drives toward peace and justice, and eager to get busy in acts of repair. Whatever the 60s was, it was prelude. Let's get busy now.
What advice do you have for young activists?
I should tell you that I'm very active in Chicago in a lot of different struggles. Certainly the struggle for decent, fair, equitable educational opportunities for all kids. I'm active in immigration rights. I'm active in Black Lives Matter. And one of the things that I feel very strongly is I have much, much less advice for others than I think the young people have advice for me. So I feel very blessed when I'm invited to a meeting and I get to be an observer. I've been in the streets a lot in the last year. I've written a lot of letters, a lot of articles, and I continue to want to be a part of that. But my feeling is that the young people are always the people who lead these movements. Why? Because they're the ones who are awakening to a world out of balance. And a world as out of balance as this world needs leadership from the people who have the energy and the vision to imagine a better world. And I feel like I take a lot of advice from the young. But in my own experience, there are kind of two dimensions I could talk about that I think are important. And I have to remind myself of these things. I don't think you can be a good activist, a moral person, a good citizen or resident without kind of following a certain rhythm. And it's easy to say, but excruciatingly difficult to enact. The rhythm is simple. Open your eyes and pay attention. Look at the world as it really is. And since it's a dynamic world, you have to open your eyes every day anew. Secondly, be astonished and don't allow yourself to be cynical. Be astonished at both the beauty and the ecstasy in every direction, and be astonished at the unnecessary suffering that human beings visit upon one another. Don't take as common sense seeing homeless children. Be outraged all over again, every day. And then third, you have to do something. You have to act. You have to open your eyes, be astonished, and act. And then the fourth thing you have to do, and there were times in my life when I failed badly on this fourth one, and that is you have to rethink. Is what I did right? Is what I did enough? Is what I did well-placed? Okay, let me start over. Open your eyes, pay attention, be astonished, act, doubt, and continue. And to me, that's the rhythm of activism. And filling it in is your life's work. I remember Rosa Luxemburg, the great revolutionary from Europe, and she was in prison during World War I for failing to support Germany in World War I. And there's a great correspondence between Rosa Luxemburg and her friends. But my favorite exchange is a woman writes to her and says, Rosa, we're lost without your leadership. What are we going to do? What can we do? And Luxemburg writes back and she says, I have two things to tell you. One is stop whining, which I think is great advice for activists. Don't whine. If you describe the world with all of its obstacles and flaws and difficulties, that's simply a description of your work. That's not something to rub your hands about and whine about and cry about. So Luxemburg says, stop whining. Then she says, my second advice is be a mensch. M-E-N-S-C-H, it's Yiddish. You can Google it. But she says, be a mensch. And I can't define mensch for you except to say that a mensch is someone who loves her own life enough to take care of the children, take care of the elders, enjoy a bottle of wine with friends, marvel at the sunrise and the sunset. But a mensch is also someone who loves the world enough to put her shoulder on history's wheel when history requires it. Work that out in practice and you'll be there. And I think the young people today get it. Self-care is critical, but care of the world is also critical. And you have to work that out in practice every day with yourself and with your comrades.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate your time and your advice and your energy and your vision.